So we did a lot of plotting. We calculated descriptive statistics. The only thing that we haven't done yet is we haven't done any comparisons. So for that, you need to do statistical tests. And before you can do any statistical test, you first have to know if your data, or your residuals at least, are normally distributed. That's always the first question that you have to answer. So, how do you do this in R? Well, to check normality of values, you can use the Shapiro.test function. What is important here? Well, it performs a Shapiro-Wilkinson test that checks normality of the data. It doesn't work when you have very small data sets. So less than 7 values per group will not work. Yeah? The test also doesn't work when you have very large data sets. So if you have more than 25 or 30 values per group, then also the outcome is not reliable. Then the test will be too stringent. So, what you do when you have smaller groups, I will come back on that later. What do you do when you have large data sets, more than 25 measurements per group? Then it's a good idea to make a histogram. Simply make a histogram and see for yourself, does it look more or less normally distributed? And even if it's a bit skewed, it doesn't matter. When you have a large data set, it's kind of robust against skew. So you can very easily assume that yes, it's normally distributed. So you have to check normality. That's one thing that you need to check. If you find that the data are normally distributed, then you also have to check if the groups have the same spread. Because some statistical tests make this assumption. How can you check if the groups have the same spread? Well, there are functions for doing that. So if you have 2 groups, you use the var.test function. If you have more than 2 groups, you use the bartlett.test function. Most of the functions that perform statistical tests, like Shapiro.test and var.test, they will only work on vectors. Now, we have already seen that. So most functions for calculating descriptive statistics, the mean, the standard deviation, the interquartile range, these things, they work only on vectors. And the same is true here. So most functions that perform statistical tests will only work on vectors. So if you have questions, why do you need to check normality, or why do you need to check the fact that the groups have equal variance, I'm not going to answer these questions here, but we have this course on the e-learning system. It's free, and that explains all these things. Okay. So once you know if the data are normally distributed and if the groups have the same spread, you can do the comparison. You can compare your groups. So what if you have 2 groups? Well, then you have these 2 functions, the t.test function and the wilcox.test function. You use this one for data that are normally distributed, and you use this one for data that are not normally distributed. Both of them, again, work on vectors only. So you give them 2 vectors, the vectors of the 2 groups that you want to compare. Sometimes you want to compare one group of measurements to a theoretical value. I measure all your heart rates and I want to see if indeed the average heart rate is 60, like they say in my biology book. Yeah? Then I have one group that I want to compare to 60. So if you want to do what is called a one sample test, you can also do this with the same functions. Yeah? You simply give one vector as an input and then the test will automatically know, it's a one sample test. So that's the input, yeah? Either one vector or two vectors. The two functions have a number of additional arguments that you can set. And you can see them on the slide. Yeah, that's all, so it's not that much. So which ones do I want to mention? Well, certainly this one. So the var.equal argument. So the default setting here is false. What does it represent, this argument? It represents the fact that the two groups have equal spread. Yeah, yes or no. So the default is no here. That means that the default t-test in R will perform a Welsh correction. And that's not always what you want. So if var.test tells you that your two groups have the same spread, then you don't want to do a Welsh correction. A Welsh correction is more stringent. You don't want to do that if it's not necessary. So if var.test tells you that the groups have the same spread, you have to change this argument. You have to set it equal to true. And then he will do a regular t-test without Welsh correction. You can set the confidence level, so the default is of course 95% confidence, what most people want. If you have dependent data, you have to set the paired argument equal to true. And then he will do a paired t-test. Yeah. So the default is an unpaired t-test. If you have dependent data, you set paired equal to true. The alternative argument allows you to do a one-sided test, but the default is two-sided, and in most cases that's the best choice. And then you have an argument called mu, and mu is linked to this. Yeah? When you want to do a one-sample test, then you want to compare one group of measurements to a theoretical value. The theoretical value is mu. Yeah? So mu is by default zero. But in the example that I gave, I want to compare if your average heart rate is 60, then mu would be 60. So that's how it works. And the nice thing is that the Wilcoxon test, yeah, so the non-parametric counterpart of the t-test, has exactly the same arguments, the same name, the same default settings. The only thing that's different is that the Wilcoxon test does not have this one, because in a Wilcoxon test, this is not relevant. Yeah? The Wilcoxon test doesn't assume that the two groups have the same variance, so it's not relevant there. Okay? All the other arguments are exactly the same. So that's nice. So they have the same arguments with the same meaning and the same default setting. What is also nice is that any t-test that you can imagine, yeah, is done by this function, by the t.test function. A one-sample t-test, that's this. A two-sample t-test with Welsh correction, that's this. A two-sample t-test without Welsh correction, well, then you change the setting of var.equal. A paired t-test, well then you change paired. All the t-tests that you can imagine are all done by this function, by just tweaking the different arguments. And the same is true for the Wilcoxon test. For the t-test, you need to know that your data are normally distributed, because you cannot do the test if that's not the case. For medium-sized data sets, you can use Shapiro.test. For large data sets, you make a histogram. What do you do when you have very small data sets? So when you have less than 7 measurements per group, you cannot do Shapiro.test in that case. So what can you do? Well, instead of checking the normality of the data, you can check the normality of the residuals. So what are residuals? Residuals come from the world of regression. When you do regression, you calculate residuals, inevitably. What are the residuals in regression? They are the difference between your points and the line. Yeah? The model that you use to represent your data. So in linear regression, the line that you're fitting to your data. You can use the same thing in a t-test or an ANOVA for that matter. So what is a residual there? Well, a residual is the difference between your data and the model that is fitted to your data. Which model is fitted by a t-test or an ANOVA? Well, for every group, the mean. Yeah, that's the model that is being used in a t-test. The mean of every group. So the residuals are calculated how by, for every group, you're going to make the difference between the data and the mean of that group. And that will give you residuals. So it will give you values, and you can check for these values if they are normally distributed, yes or no. Yeah? For an ANOVA, it's important that you do that. Yeah? So for an ANOVA, it's not so important that the data are normally distributed, but it's much more important that the residuals are normally distributed. An ANOVA is much more sensitive to that. For a t-test, well, you typically check the data. Yeah? You check that the data are normally distributed. But if you don't have enough data to check it, you can check the residuals. Why? Well, if you check normality of the data using Shapiro.test, you will do that for each group individually. So you need 7 replicates per group. When you check normality of the residuals, you typically do that on all the residuals together, for all the groups combined. So that means that to check normality of residuals, you need at least 7 values in total. And that's something that you probably have. Yeah. So 7 values in total over all your groups, that's not so unlikely. Okay? So if you have small data sets, you check normality of the residuals instead of the normality of the data. That means that you need to have access to the residuals. So what is annoying about the t.test function, this one, it's not calculating or it's not returning the residuals. It doesn't give you the residuals. Which function does give residuals? Well, this one, the LM function. LM stands for linear model. And you can use it as an alternative for the t.test function. And you can also use it to do ANOVA on your data. So all the parametric tests where you're going to compare groups, 2 groups, 3 groups, 4 groups or more, can be done by this function, LM. In this way, this function is much more general than the t.test function. This will compare 2 groups, and that's it. Eh? You cannot use this one to do an ANOVA, to compare 3 or 4 groups. Yeah? It's just 2 groups. So this is much more general. It can compare 2 groups, 3 groups, 4 groups. Many groups defined by multiple grouping variables, it can do it all. Yeah. The LM function. Okay. How does the LM function work? Well, it has 3 important arguments. It needs a formula. I will come back on that in the next slide. It needs the data, so a data frame with the data. So this is a function that works on a data frame. It doesn't need vectors as input. It works on a data frame. If you don't want to use the whole data frame, you even have the subset argument to define which part of the data frame that you want to use. Okay. What is important for this function? Well, what this function doesn't like is factors, grouping variables, where the groups are represented by numbers. Yeah. Again, we are here. Yeah. So if you have groups in your data and the groups are called 3, 4, 5, and 6, LM will not like it. If that's the case, you have to factorize that column. You have to factorize that grouping variable. So using the factor function. If you have two groups and they're called 3 and 4, you will also not like it, but then if you don't want to factorize, you can also convert the 3 and the 4 into 0 and 1. So if you use numbers to represent the groups in your data, it has to be 0 and 1. Otherwise, you have to use the factor function. It's very sensitive to that. The LM function assumes that the data are normal. Eh? It's an alternative for a t-test and an ANOVA. All tests that you do on normally distributed data, or at least data with normally distributed residuals. That's the most important. LM only works on independent data, so it's not an alternative for a paired t-test. No? If you need a paired t-test, you go for this function. LM will not be a good solution there. And it assumes that your groups have equal variance, the same spread. Yeah? So it makes a lot of assumptions. Okay, the formula. What is a formula about? So we have seen formulas before. It's these things in R that contain a tilde. Or how can you read the tilde? You can read the tilde as is modeled by. So when it represents a model, what do you put in front of the tilde? Well, the thing that you want to model. What do you want to model? Well, your measurements. So the things that you have measured. So in case of the baby's data set, remember, it's the birth weights of the babies, the things that you have measured. That comes in front of the tilde. What comes after the model, the tilde? After the tilde come the thing that defines the groups in your data. So in case of the baby's data, the smoking behavior of the mother. Yeah? That defines groups in my data. So I'm going to model my measurements according to the column that defines the groups in my data. That's how a formula works. And you can have one grouping variable here after the tilde, but you can also have multiple grouping variables after the tilde. If you have more than one, you separate them by a plus. So here you're going to model the birth weights of the babies according to smoking behavior of the mother and education level of the mother. There can be multiple factors grouping variables here after the tilde. When you have more than one grouping variable, you make a distinction between main effects and the interaction. So main effects means that you're going to look at the overall effect of the smoking behavior on the birth weights. And you're going to look at the overall effect of the education level on the birth weights. So the main effects, yeah? The overall effect of the education level over all the categories of smoking behavior. If you think that these two grouping variables influence each other, so that the effect of the smoking behavior is different for every category of education level, then it means that you think that there is an interaction between your two grouping variables. How do you represent an interaction here by a column? So the column here represents that you're looking at the interaction between these two grouping variables. So this is only the interaction. This here, the star sign, the asterisk, represents the main effects plus the interaction. So here you only look at the main effects. Here you only look at the interaction when you write it like this, and here you look at everything, at the main effects and the interaction. That's basically how it works. Now, these things are only relevant for two-way ANOVA. That's the only case where you have two grouping variables. So for a simple t-test or a simple one-way ANOVA, you will only have one grouping variable. So you end up here in this simple case, where you have a simple formula. So and when smoke defines two categories, then LM will do a t-test. When smoke defines three or more categories, then LM will do a one-way ANOVA. So he will decide for you depending on how many groups are defined here by this factor. Okay. The output of the LM function is always saved in a variable. And then you can use these results, you can use the output of the LM function as input for many packages. So I listed the most important packages here. You have the broom package that allows you to generate a nice overview of the results of the statistical test using the tidy function, or using the augment function, it allows you to see the residuals. Yeah? So using the output of the LM function, you can get access to the residuals. I will show you in our studio, it will be more clear there. Okay. So if you do a t-test or an LM with two groups then, it will give exactly the same result. Yeah? So this is the output of the t-test. So you get the means of the two groups. You get the statistics, so the t-value. You will get a p-value for the test. You will get the degrees of freedom. You will see the confidence interval for the difference between the two groups. So the difference itself, you have to calculate it by doing minus here. This is the confidence interval for the difference. And here he will tell you what kind of t-test you have done. So this is the output of the t.test function. This is the output on the same data of the LM function. So you see here the mean of the first group. What you see here is not the mean of the second group, but it's the difference between the two groups. So when you do this minus this, you will get this number, this value. He doesn't give you a confidence interval for the difference, but he gives you the standard error. So you can calculate the confidence interval yourself using this formula. He gives you the statistic, that's the same, of course, and he gives you the p-value, which is also the same. So they generate the same results. Different layouts, but the same results. They are the same. Now, one of the reasons why you would go for LM instead of the t.test function is you have small data sets and you want to check if the residuals are normally distributed. There is a package, OLSRR, that has functions that allow you to do that very easily. So these functions, they use the output of LM as input. Yeah, input here. What will they do? So this one will make a QQ plot of the residuals, where you can see if they are normally distributed. This will do a test, a statistical test on the residuals to see if they're normally distributed. And this will make another plot, another type of plot. I'm going to show it in our studio. So, but this package allows you to check the residuals based on the output of the LM function. They cannot work with the output of the t.test function because the t.test does not generate the residuals as an output. So basically, if you do a t-test, the result will look like this in your console, and you will get all the information except for the actual difference between the two groups. You will get all the information that you need to report. If you do a Wilcoxon test, you get this as an output. So you will have to do a few additional calculations to get all the information that you need to report here. Yeah, this is what you need to report. If you do a paired t-test, this is the output and it contains all the information that you need to report. So more information on how to report the results of your statistical tests in the e-learning system in the statistics theory course. So if you need to do multiple t-tests, so you have a data set with proteins, like the data set we used for the heat map, with proteins in the rows, and for each protein you want to see if it's differentially expressed, well, it means that for each protein you will have to do one separate t-test. But in total, you're going to do 60 t-tests, one for each protein. So in this case, you want to do multiple tests, one per row, one per protein. How can you do that? Well, very simple, you use the apply function. That's one of the reasons why we saw the apply function. So when do you typically do this? You do this for qPCR data. Yeah? Then you want to see for each gene if it's differentially expressed. So what is generated by qPCR is a data set with genes in the rows, samples in the columns, and for each gene you want to check if it's differentially expressed, yes or no. So for qPCR data. For small-scale proteomics experiments, so if you have a limited number of proteins that you measured and you want to see for each of the proteins if it's differentially expressed, then it's this apply. For metabolomics data, so you have a set of metabolites. For each metabolite, you have measurements. You want to check if it's differentially expressed. So also there, well, expressed, you know what I mean. There, you use this. For bulk RNA-seq data, for large-scale proteomics experiments, you have better solutions than this. So specific packages that will help you. But for the small-scale experiments, this is how to go. So you use the apply function, and in the apply function, you can use the LM function, or you can use the t.test function, or you can use the Wilcox.test function. Whatever you need can be put inside the apply. Yeah? So this allows you to do one per row. That's what apply does. Now, after you have done the apply, you will get a bunch of p-values, one for each gene or one for each protein. But these are not correct p-values. Since you have done multiple tests on the same data set, you will have to do a multiple testing correction. And how can you do that? Well, by using this function, the p.adjust function. What does it take as input? A vector with p-values. So apply will generate a vector with p-values, one for each protein, and then you're going to use this vector in the p.adjust function to correct the p-values. And you can set a method for doing the correction. So if it's a limited number, you set method equal to Bonferroni. If it's 60 proteins, then I would go for Benjamini-Hochberg.